Good morning. Roller coaster, a whirlwind of weather conditions hit the nation this week. Coming up, a weekend warm-up and your outlook next week for East Central Indiana.
Remembering a space icon, one space hero laid to rest after his death last December, his impact on the world next.
So we don't know. We have no idea.
MCS drama, Muncie Community Schools on the brink of a state takeover. At 8:30, the impact it could have on you and the community.
Get the coffee ready and open up those eyes. You're waking up with Cardinal Weather.
From Ball State Unified Media, you're waking up with Cardinal Weather with Molly, Tanner, Emerson, Kaylee, and David, live from the Ball State Weather Center.
Good morning. You're waking up with Cardinal Weather, and you're looking live at our location of the week, Boston. Massachusetts. Boston, yes, Boston. Where it is a brisk 45 degrees with some cloud cover out there in Boston, but Tanner's still looking nice on the East Coast.
Oh yeah, always looking nice in Boston.
Exactly. Well, meanwhile, back here inside the Ball State Weather Center, I'm Emerson Lehman.
And I'm Tanner Holbrook. Thanks for joining us this morning. David Seith will be along with us in just a little while, but first, we begin with Nathan DeYoung, who has a look at the severe weather that has pummeled the South. Nathan?
Yeah, guys, it's been quite a ride of week of weather here in the United States. The southeastern United States and the Midwest are still recovering today after a week of severe weather that took wrath on each of the regions. Impacts included torrential raining and flooding, widespread hail, and multiple reports of tornadoes. The National Weather Service issued tornado warnings for communities in multiple states and reported numerous on-the-ground twisters in Georgia, Indiana, and South Carolina. In Webster County, Georgia, winds collapsed a warehouse building. Power crews were on the scene trying to repair what was left of the lines. Elsewhere, even more destruction to a group of homes on a chicken farm were included in that damage. There were no reports of injuries. A school janitor is also speaking out after surviving a tornado that devastated an elementary school he was working at. Tiffany Alanez reports.
We tracked down Lindell Ulmer, better known as Lucky, in nearby Neosho.
Mr. Ulmer?
Yeah.
Hi. I'm Tiffany. Nice. I'm so glad you're all right, sir.
Just hours after surviving this destruction, Lucky asked to go help clean another school.
I look into work, sitting around.
Lucky says he was aware of the storms coming as he was working at Goodman Elementary Tuesday night.
And then the sirens went off and I could hear debris hitting on that side.
Lucky says he didn't waste time.
I'm not one to really get scared or worried about stuff, but I don't know, just something told me to take cover, so I'm usually one of them people out watching.
He ran to a staff bathroom and took cover. When he came out,
the whole center of the roof was off and debris was just everywhere down the hallway.
After a call to his boss, Lucky called his wife.
I just told her and I said, I'm all right.
This is his truck in the parking lot.
Yeah, 07, 84,000 miles, and not a scratch on it.
Lucky says he's sad to lose his truck, but knows it could have been worse.
It's just unreal. I mean, I've never been through anything like that before.
And the irony of his 20-year nickname isn't lost on him.
Do you think you were lucky?
Yeah, somebody's watching over me.
What an amazing story. Ulmer also hasn't lost his sense of humor. After things calmed down, Ulmer said that he told the other custodian that works for him that she had a big mess to clean up.
It was a sombering day yesterday as the final funeral rites for astronaut and Senator John Glenn took place at the Arlington National Cemetery. Glenn, who passed away in December, was laid to rest on he and his wife Annie's anniversary per a family request. Fellow astronauts, along with dignitaries, were present to pay their final respects to the first American to orbit the Earth.
Peggy Whitson, a 57-year-old NASA astronaut, is about to break more records. She is the first woman to ever command the International Space Station and currently holds the most spacewalks by any woman. Whitson's new record will be one she will thoroughly enjoy. Right now, she is aboard the ISS and is about to extend her stay by 3 months, which will give her the title of most consecutive days in space by a woman. Whitson says, quote, "This is great news. I love being up here. Living and working aboard the space station is where I feel like I make the greatest contribution." This is currently her third mission to the station and will return back to Earth later this year.
Tragedy hit Catoa, Colombia on Saturday when an avalanche devastated the city, claiming more than 270 victims. The search for survivors continued into this week as 220 people were still reported missing as of Monday. Many of the residents were asleep when the heavy rainfall that the city had been receiving for 4 days caused three rivers to overflow, causing the avalanche. The Colombian Red Cross reported they had received 374 reports from families unable to locate their loved ones. And now it's time for a check with the weather with David.
Thank you, Emerson. Yeah, we're seeing very nice conditions. Taking a look at our live cam on top of Teachers College. Sitting here across McKinley Avenue, a very gorgeous morning, but it is very chilly out there and the winds will start to ramp up later on the afternoon. We are currently sitting here at 35 degrees with those west-northwest winds at 9 miles per hour. Factor that into the temperature, it feels like 28 degrees out there, so make sure to bundle up as you walk throughout campus today. Temperatures across central Indiana, pretty cool this morning. 35 in the Circle City, 35 in Bloomington, 35 again in Terre Haute. So really mid-30s throughout the entire Indiana area. As we take a look at our winds right now, they will start to increase later on this afternoon. 15 miles per hour right now in Indianapolis, west-northwest wind again here in Muncie. So it will be very windy later on this afternoon. Taking a look at our radar right now, we will talk about what this blue is coming up in our full forecast. And we will be continuing to see those cool down temperatures later on today and into the morning tomorrow. We will be seeing windy conditions ramp up as well. Temperatures will be very warm. All that after your weather now.
Welcome back to Waking Up with Cardinal Weather. With the severe weather season in full swing, it's important to have a dedicated safe place for you and your family to go when severe weather hits. In order to encourage everyone to designate a safe place in their home or office, the National Weather Service decided to host the hashtag Safe Space Selfie campaign. The campaign took place this week with people from all over posting selfies in their safe place. The National Weather Service has been posting the most original and creative selfies on their social media accounts. And now, David, it's good to see people preparing for severe weather. Are we expecting any in Muncie this weekend?
Well, unfortunately, yeah, fortunately, we won't be seeing any severe weather, but we will be seeing a lot of sunshine for the weekend. Right now, we are seeing all these blue advisories out here. This is actually a frost advisory that is for Delaware County and all of central Indiana. And this goes until 12 a.m. this evening, Saturday morning until Saturday morning at 9 a.m. So there will be some frost on the ground tomorrow morning. So make sure to have that scriper out, as Tanner said a few shows ago, tomorrow morning as you go to your car. We are seeing temperatures in the mid-30s right now. Windy as well, 9 miles per hour. Feels like 28 degrees. So make sure you bundle up out there as you travel throughout campus or to work if you are headed there this morning. Looking at temperatures across the board here, 35 in Indianapolis, 37 our hotspot in Shelbyville, 34 for you out in Champaign. So fairly cool this morning, but temperatures will start to ramp up. Taking a look at our winds again, these will start to ramp up, increase by later on this afternoon. 10 miles per hour to the west, northwest in Terre Haute, 13 miles per hour in Lafayette. Here in Muncie, again, 9 miles per hour. Again, it will be very chilly, and wind chills will be fairly cool later on this afternoon. Going into precision cast, guys, not a lot to talk about for Friday evening and into Saturday morning. So it will be a fairly nice day, fairly sunny out there, but temperatures will only reach to about 50 degrees. Here in your 9 a.m. hour, we will be at that 35 degrees. 12 p.m. hour, 43, and those breezing conditions will start to ramp up. Northwest winds, 18 miles per hour by your noon hour. 3 p.m. hour, northwest winds at 18, and then we will start to see that gentle decrease for those winds for the later on hours in the evening. Now going into Saturday into Sunday, don't have much to talk about. It's going to be a very nice couple days ahead. Sunday looks to be our best day, but sunny skies will continue for the rest of the weekend. So it's going to be a very nice weekend. Get out and enjoy it, because rain will be increasing for Monday into Tuesday as well. So for tomorrow, we will hit a high of 62 degrees with gentle winds, finally, southwest winds 5 to 10 miles per hour. And again, areas of frost for the morning. And taking a look at your 7-day forecast, guys. Very comfortable temperatures coming up. But again, the best chances of rain come on Monday morning or Monday evening into Tuesday morning. So, but look at those temperatures, 60s and a 70 degree mark on Sunday.
That's what I'm really looking forward to, is that 70 degree mark. But David, we know you've been giving us updates throughout the semester about the monthly temperature averages, right?
Of course.
And the records throughout the world. Are there any new updates regarding the month of March?
Yeah, Tanner, unfortunately we can. That record-breaking streak of monthly temperatures, the average temperature for the month of March in the contiguous United States was officially set at 46 degrees. That's nearly 5 degrees higher than this 20th century average and the ninth warmest March on record. Officials say the record and near record warmth span 13 states in the West and Great Plains. However, the Northeast, dealt with below average temperatures last month. The March numbers continue the above average trend for United States temperatures this year. Since the 1st of the January, the average U.S. temperatures is more than 5 degrees above the 20th century average.
All right, David, thank you. Well, Ball State student Ellen Wagner is a senior biology major who was named on Monday as the 2017 National Science Foundation Graduate Research Fellowship. Wagner is one of 2,000 STEM students nationwide to receive this award, and the award provides Wagner with a $46,000 for tuition, fees, and living expenses, and upon completing her graduate work, Wagner will pursue a career in academia. Good for her.
That's right, Tanner. A very cool story there. And now, wireless emergency alert systems are continuing to make a positive impact. On the night of February 19th, as tornadic thunderstorms tore through northern San Antonio, Texas, Audrey Gagne and her husband were traveling home from Dallas. Unaware of the threat for tornadoes, the couple continued to drive through the heavy rain until an alert popped up on Gagne's phone. She and her husband pulled into a convenience store parking lot and decided to wait out the storm. Once they returned home, they were glad they were listening to the warning, discovering lots of damage in the area from tornadoes. Gagne said, quote, "If we had kept driving, there's no telling what could have happened." And stories like these are not uncommon and are all thanks to the efforts of National Weather Service forecasters activating the WEA. Gagne credits them with saving her and her husband's lives. And Tanner, that's just a great story to see that those alerts are really working.
Oh, sure. Yeah, really keeping people informed about the severe weather that's coming.
Definitely. And now we turn to a new segment, which is one that will keep you more informed.
Yeah, Emerson, that's right. Instead of weather and space news, we introduce a general news segment, which will tell you the news that you need to know for the day. So without further ado, here is your news at 8:30.
Good morning, I'm Max Lewis in the newsroom with the latest in the Muncie Community School saga. As Newslink Indiana reported this week, 5 Muncie schools are at risk of being closed after a recent decision from a state fact finder. However, some say the effects of those closings could be detrimental to teachers and students. After a state fact finder ruled in favor of the Muncie Teachers Association this weekend, the response from Muncie Community Schools was swift. The school corporation sent out a press release saying, quote, "We will need to cut nearly $2 million. This is about the amount saved by closing 4 elementary schools and a middle school."
Teachers are putting their houses up for sale. They're applying for jobs elsewhere.
Vicki Jeffers is a choir teacher at Northside Middle School. She's been a teacher for more than 31 years. She says after the statement from MCS, teachers began to panic.
When they're on their lunchtime and they're together talking, there are some tears. When we talk after school, there are some tears. What am I going to do? You know, why are we going through this?
At a board meeting last month, it was announced that 8 administrators were notified that there was a chance their contracts wouldn't be renewed. One came from Westview Elementary, another from Northview Elementary, but 3 of the names came from Northside Middle School. According to recent enrollment numbers from MCS, those 3 schools have more than 1,300 students. All of them, plus more, would have to be transferred to other area schools. As for Vicki Jeffer, she says the future is just uncertain.
So we don't know. We have no idea. When asked, are we moving? Are we merging, we were told, no, you're closing.
And meanwhile, Muncie Community Schools is inching closer to a government takeover. Yesterday, the House passed the bill that would allow for the state to take over Muncie Community Schools. Now, the bill will then head to the Senate, and if it is approved, it will go to the desk of Governor Eric Holcomb to be signed. Tanner Emerson.
NewsLink Indiana's Max Lewis in the newsroom for us. Thanks, Max. Now turning to news that broke last night.
The United States launching a military strike against the Syrian regime in retaliation for the chemical weapons attack on its own civilians earlier in the week. Kristen Holmes is in Washington, D.C. with the latest.
Tonight I ordered a targeted military strike on the airfield in Syria from where the chemical attack was launched.
Under President Trump's orders, the United States launching a missile strike in Syria. He said it was a response to the Assad regime's chemical weapons attack on civilians, including children, earlier in the week.
Using a deadly nerve agent, Assad choked out the lives of helpless men, women, and children.
According to U.S. officials, U.S. warships launching 59 Tomahawk cruise missiles from the Mediterranean Sea, hitting the Syrian military airbase that carried out those chemical attacks. This strike marks the first direct military action the U.S. has taken against Bashar al-Assad during Syria's six-year civil war. A stark change in President Trump's position on U.S. involvement in Syria, which he opposed during his campaign and even before, urging President Obama in 2013 not to attack Syria. Lawmakers on Capitol Hill largely supporting the president's actions.
The days of being able to act with impunity are over when it comes to Bashar al-Assad.
Russia has backed the Assad regime, Russian President Vladimir Putin calling the airstrikes a, quote, act of aggression and a serious blow to U.S.-Russia relations. In Washington, I'm Kristen Holmes.
And that's a look at your news at 8:30. Coming up, we'll take a look at what's trending now. Plus, we'll check in with Kaylee and Molly, who are live in Boston. That's after your weather now. Back now, 8:33 a.m., and it's time for one of our favorite segments, Trending Now. And now we have all heard about the movie Frozen, and perhaps we've sang along a time or two. Okay, maybe just me. However, these two toddlers take it to a whole new level. They have choreographed one of their favorite scenes from the popular Disney film, and their mother was able to capture the performance on tape, sending the video viral. And guys, what an adorable story here.
Honestly, when you compare the TV screen to what's actually happening in real life, there's really no difference.
No, they are spot on with their, and what are they, maybe 2 years old,
yeah,
possibly?
Yeah, very smart.
That's incredible.
Well, moving on, it's flood season even in the desert, and this footage is from a gentleman captured in the desert. The man who captured the footage has been living in the desert region for around 25 years, and this is the first time he said he's seen anything like this. This is something you don't really see every day, Nathan, right?
No, it's not. The desert oftentimes sees a period of rainfall, which we call the rainy season in many parts of the world, and in just this case that this area had seen rain in the mountains, and rain obviously naturally follows those aquifers back down to rivers and streams, and in this case he got an amazing shot of a dry riverbed that amazingly enough had flash flooding. And you know, with flash flooding, it takes everything in its path, and you saw the trees, the roots, anything that's in that way, all the way through.
Well, jeez. Yeah,
this guy's taking a risk for staying there. I mean, these mudslides can be...
And flash flooding can be dangerous,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, these mudslides can travel about 50 miles per hour.
Wow.
In some cases.
Crazy.
So very dangerous.
Crazy footage there in the desert. Now time for some space news with Tanner. Launching rockets is a tough task, so tough that each mission has an insurance policy just in case something goes wrong. In 1988, Congress found that private insurers didn't have the necessary resources to insure a space launch disaster. So in response, Congress passed amendments to the Commercial Space Launch Act, which updated the law to create a safety cushion of up to $1.5 billion. However, the cost of this insurance is outdated, and the director of the Government Accountability Office, Alicia Cackley, says, quote, "We don't think that the 1988 estimate is realistic anymore, just based off of the cost of living, if nothing else." However, the GAO says updating those figures could pose other risks in the industry, citing that if casualty numbers increase, it could increase the rate of private insurers dramatically. Now let's take a look at local or national weather with Nathan.
Good morning. We do have some national weather going on. We talked earlier about the roller coaster that we were on. Now we're starting to calm down. Here's radar all across the nation. Much of the Midwest remains calm at this time. Another low pressure system off the West Coast there is allowing them to see some rain this morning up in places of Oregon and up into the Seattle area. You notice a few rain showers in the mountains this morning. That's because of that low pressure off the coast, bringing in that air from the Pacific Ocean this morning down to the Southwest this morning. Places all the way through California continue to see that. Many places in the mountains see snow. These pink boxes here are all indicating winter storm warnings at this time. But into the desert Southwest, cloudy conditions to start the morning. Temperatures remain quite mild there. In the upper Midwest, we continue to see some clouds in the remnants of a low pressure system that actually moved through our area last night, but continue to see just a few rain showers off into Canada and down into the south, where they were struck with tons of damage and lots of severe weather starting on Sunday. You notice that conditions are finally clear for them. We're seeing sunny skies and a little bit warmer air this morning than we had. But here in the Midwest, especially here in Indiana and the Ohio Valley, we continue to see cold air dip down from Canada this morning, allowing us to see a frost advisory beginning tonight. A few snow showers off to the East Coast. You notice most of the East Coast down the seaboard remains calm with a few clouds, but we continue to see some snow showers. Places like Buffalo, it's still snowing this morning, so not too best of conditions for them. National current temperatures, you notice, pretty chilly out there. We see a big cool air pool that continues to set over much of the United States. 35 degrees here in Muncie, but today's high 70 degrees in Billings, 64 in Los Angeles today, and that'll be a change that we continue to watch over the next couple days. And that's because Precision Cast shows that low pressure system continue to track right across the Canadian border, which will allow many places across the West to see some snow and rain showers. But by the time we get to here, we'll have that. Let's take one more last look at your 7-day forecast here locally, because local weather is our priority here on Waking Up with Cardinal WX. If you notice, Sunday, 71 degrees, which will be a nice change to our weather forecast, at least.
I'm looking forward to that 71, honestly.
Oh, yeah.
Spring is in the air, guys. Spring is in the air.
Summer's not far behind.
That's
pretty excited. All right. Well, thank you, Nathan. Now, you may have noticed we are down two people on Waking Up with Cardinal Weather this morning. Kaylee Plutchel and Molly Coates are at the American Association of Geographers Conference in Boston, Massachusetts. Good morning, guys. Can you share what's up with you two? Where are you guys at?
Such a great time here. As much as we miss being inside there, I think we might want to stay in Boston. Definitely one of the top cities I visited.
Yes, for sure.
And we just had a great time here. We're here for the AAG conference, as someone mentioned there. So we're having a great time. Yesterday was our big conference day. So we were mostly there, which is at the convention center downtown. And so that was a lot of fun. We got to see a lot of great speakers, learned a lot of stuff about geography. So we were talking about climate and geography, which is really fun, but it hasn't been all work. We definitely have had some fun here while we've been in Boston. So
yeah.
What did we do?
We went to the Quincy Market the other day, which was a lot of fun. We shopped a lot and got a lot of cool gifts.
Yes.
We've also been to the aquarium, and we've done a lot of sightseeing around just Boston in general. Brooklyn is beautiful.
Yes, definitely a great area to stay in. It's not so like the hustle and bustle of downtown, definitely more of like a local feel. Boston College is right down the street from us. We have a lot more, so we're here for two more days.
too, which is really cool. Yes, it's really packed.
Yeah, it was very stressful. Not as bad as the subway in New York, but we're finally getting it down. Different color trains and everything, so that's working out well. For the rest of today, we're pretty excited to continue to sightsee. We're going to be going to WBZ in Boston to visit Pamela Gardner, her whole state grad today, so that'll be really exciting. And what else are we doing today?
We're also going to Harvard, which is a lot of fun. So we'll get to see that campus. And we get to try the Boston Burger Company, which is known for their massive milkshakes.
Yes, we're very excited about the milkshakes. Yes.
But we're really excited to see you guys when we get back. Enjoy the rest of the show, and we'll see you around.
Have a good morning.
Looks like there's a lot more shopping and visiting places rather than a conference attending. I'm just kidding, guys. Thanks, guys, for joining us this morning. In just a few moments, I'll have your weather history and also your pop culture rundown. That's after your weather now. Back now, 42 past the hour. It's time for weather history. On this date in 1980, severe thunderstorm spawned tornadoes, which ripped through central Arkansas. The same storm system produced very high winds and baseball-sized hail. Wow. President Carter had declared 5 counties under a disaster area.
As severe weather season is upon us, and different weather terms keep coming up, it is a good time to review what happens during extreme weather events. Scientists at the Storm Prediction Center in Norman, Oklahoma, look at weather forecasts every day, looking at current and future conditions. If they see an area where the conditions are in favor of either severe thunderstorms or tornadoes, they will issue a watch for a large area. When the event is occurring and ongoing, warnings will be issued for storms that have shown the qualifications for either a severe thunderstorm warning or a tornado warning. A severe thunderstorm warning requires hail to be at least 1 inch and winds of excess of 58 miles per hour. Now, if there is a radar signature of a possible tornado or spotted a confirmed tornado on the ground, then they will immediately issue a tornado warning. In the worst case scenario for extreme weather, we sometimes hear of a PDS. This simply means a particularly dangerous situation, where it is just a heightened warning. A lot of PDS tornado warnings are issued when there is a confirmed tornado on the ground doing a lot of damage to property and even loss of life. Now, for the future, when you hear these storms, you can be even more prepared when severe weather strikes.
Interesting information there. Now it's time for pop culture today. Emerson and I are in with that.
That's right, we had to fill in for Kaylee and Molly while they're in Boston. Well, we will try and do our best to do it justice. The American Country Music Awards took place to showcase the best in country music in the one and only Las Vegas. Luke Bryan and Dierks Bentley hosted the event. Some of the best moments from the show were the amazing Faith Hill and Tim McGraw performing together, Florida Georgia Line partnering up with the Backstreet Boys, and Thomas Rhett in disbelief in his winning speech, and many more moments. Other performances included Lady Antebellum, Keith Urban with Carrie Underwood, and Little Big Town. Here are some of the winners from Sunday: Entertainer of the Year, Jason Aldean; Female Vocalist of the Year, Miranda Lambert; Male Vocalist of the Year, Thomas Rhett; Single Record of the Year, Holy by Florida Georgia Line; and Song of the Year, Die a Happy Man by Thomas Rhett. Congrats to them and the many more who won at the ACMS. And the popular Broadway musical Wicked is finally transforming the wonderful tale into a movie. You'll have to wait to put your ruby slippers on until December 20th, 2019. Wicked is a tale that shows the stories behind the witches. The,
The musical first took to Broadway on October 30th, 2003, and has been playing ever since. This will definitely will be a movie to see in 2019. And now let's take it to David with one final look at the weather, David.
Yeah, guys. Well, the biggest story of the next 7 days is going to be warm temperatures. I mean, look at those temperatures, 62 on Saturday, 71 on Sunday. But our next best chances of rain come in Monday and Tuesday, Monday night into Tuesday morning, 69 on Monday. Cold front comes through, knocks down temperatures a little bit, 64 on Tuesday, but then still staying in the 60s for the middle part of next week. So definitely spring is in the air, like you said earlier, Emerson. So very nice weather ahead.
Yeah, definitely looking forward to that 71 degrees on Sunday. Thanks, David, for that look at final weather. That's all for Cardinal Weather. Make sure to follow us on our Snapchat, username CardinalWX.
And be sure to like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter if you have not already. Have a great rest of your Friday and a fantastic week.